I'm sure many have had an experience similar to this. If you've lived it from Idaho, or you're from the West, really, but in particular, I think of Idaho, because that's where I'm from. For any length of time, you've had probably had an experience like this of some sort if you've ever managed to travel outside of this state, or in particular, if you've ever gone to the East or somewhere like that. It's amazing to me how often when I travel, in particular for my job, that I'll go somewhere, and people have a hard time realizing that the state of Idaho is much larger than the state of Boise. And it's funny, they don't even really understand the size of Boise for that matter, because it never fails they'll mention to me somebody they know from Idaho and expect that I should know them. Like there's only 12 of us here. And they're just flabbergasted when I tell them I don't know that person. Matter of fact, I don't know very many people in Boise at all. And they're like, well, how far from Boise are you? When I explain to them we are 2.5 hours away, the look on their face is inexplicable. It's as if I live in a foreign country. Now, we've all probably had an experience similar to that of some sort. But it's interesting to me that look that people assume you should know somebody just because you happen to be in the same vicinity of them. Because you happen to be in the same location as them. Sometimes people assume that we know people because we live in the same city as them. We've heard many, many people tell us before, don't you know that person? And they seem almost upset that you don't. We're going to talk about knowing somebody this morning. We're going to talk about knowing the one somebody that everybody should desire to know. The one somebody who can be known. Better than you and I can know each other, this person can be known to you, and you are known of this person. We're going to talk about our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now you're thinking, how did he possibly get there from the text we read this morning? I don't know. Hopefully we get there. You'll remember that we just got done going through verses 16 and 17, talking about the gospel of Christ and talking about how the just should live by faith. And in contrast now, the Lord takes us right into verse 18 where he says, for the wrath of God revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. There's two different classes of people who are mentioned here. There's the ungodly and there's the unrighteous. Those are two different distinct groups of people. And I think it's best for us to understand this as we start to think about these two groups. We can understand the difference between the ungodly and the unrighteous. The ungodly simply are the wicked, those who do not know God, do not know of God. And then there's the unrighteous, those who should know God, those who have learned of God, those who have heard the gospel of Christ, and yet choose unbelief. But it's interesting to me that both of these people suffer the same plague, and that is the wrath of God. I love, and I'm going to jump ahead a little bit here, but I love at verse 20, the end of verse 20, that he says that God can be known. He tells us how God can be known, and he says this. He says, so that they are without excuse. There is not an excuse for not knowing Jesus Christ. There is not an answer when we come before the white throne judgment of God that we're going to be able to give that is going to justify our position and not bowing our knee to our Savior, Jesus Christ. There's not an answer we can give. We can't say, but I didn't know. And we can't say, I knew, but I didn't believe. We can't blame the Christians. I would have believed if they didn't act like that. We have no excuse, is the point. Now, I know that for the majority, I'm speaking to believers in this room this morning, and I praise God for that. And it has always been my firm conviction that the Bible is written to believers, and so we're going to look at this from a believer standpoint. But before we do that, I want to understand a little bit more about this group of the ungodly and the unrighteous. I think one of the best ways for us to understand the difference between the ungodly and the unrighteous is to look at the first real mention, or the first mention of the law, or the law given by God, from Exodus chapter 20. We're all familiar with that. Go and turn back to Exodus chapter 20. This is the Ten Commandments. See, we don't get to say that the Old Testament doesn't apply, that we're New Testament believers. Our God is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Everything he said applies to us, and we should learn from it and glean from it. The easiest way, I believe, for us to discover the difference between these two groups is by looking simply at the Ten Commandments. Now, I'm not going to take us all the way through this entire chapter and verse by verse through the Ten Commandments, but let's just start by looking at the first four commandments here. The first one we find, really in all honesty, is in Exodus chapter 20, verse 3. Where the Lord says, "Thou shalt have no other gods before me." Then in verse 4, he says, "Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image, or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or to earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth." And then down to verse 7, he says, "Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain." And verse 8 through 10, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath day of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates." These first four commandments describe to us the ungodly. Those who do not reverence God, who do not know God, have no knowledge of him. Those who honestly can't say, "Well, I knew of him, but I ignored him." This is those who would blaspheme him by saying there is no God, for example. But we know that Psalms chapter 14, verse 1 tells us that the fool has said in his heart, "There is no God." Praise be to God, none of us hopefully sitting here this morning say there is no God. There is no God. The second group, the unrighteous, are in all honesty described in the next six commandments. The first one we find in verse 12. "Honor thy father and thy mother, that the days may be long upon thy land, which the Lord thy God giveth thee." Just pause there for a moment. Just as a little interesting side note. Of all the commandments that are given, did you know this is the one that has a promise? To honor thy mother and father, that your days may be long. That means, children, we get to take you out if we want to. I'm teasing. Obviously, we'd be breaking the next couple commandments here. Thou shalt not kill. But there is a promise there. And I want you to understand something. This has to do with the relationship. Honor in thy mother and thy father. What does it mean to honor? To reverence. To hold in respect and regard. If there's one problem with most of our society, I believe it can be explained by that one verse. That we don't reverence or honor our mother and our father. And I see that in the church, unfortunately. I see children who disrespect their parents. And it breaks my heart. I jokingly tell the kids, but it was truth, that if we were living back with the Jews in the olden days, and I saw you dishonoring your parent, it was my obligation as a member of that society to let them know. And we would take you outside the gates and we'd stone you to death. And then I get those, "Well, I don't do anything mean against my parents." And we know there's a lot of types of communication, aren't there? There's the verbal. Of course, there's the kids who actually will be brazen enough to say something disrespectful to their parents. But then there's those who just give that look. This is the thing I've been dealing with my son the most lately. Right? That I chastise him or I correct him. And he gives me that look of, "Oh, gosh, here we go again." Right? And sometimes it even accompanies a sigh. Right? "You are just so stupid." God put it into the commandments, I think he takes it pretty serious. And we as parents should take it serious too. And I believe that we should, and I know I'm going down a road here, I'm going to come back to what we're talking about this morning, but I believe we honestly should, as parents, do whatever it takes to get our children to reverence us. I tell my son all the time, you know what, Jaden, I love you, and so I have to provide certain things for you. I have clothes for you, and I have food for you, and I have a roof over your head, but guess what? You don't have to have anything else. You don't need to have a cell phone. You don't need to have a car when you get old enough to drive. You don't have to have a TV. You don't have to have entertainment. You don't have to have a job. You don't need any of that stuff. That you should learn not to blaspheme the Lord by dishonoring your father or mother. Sorry. I don't know why I got on that track. Maybe Jaden did something this morning that made me upset and I don't realize it. But continuing on in our passage here, speaking of the unrighteous. Verse 13 says this, thou shalt not kill. Verse 14, thou shalt not commit adultery. Verse 15, thou shalt not steal. Verse 16, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. Verse 17, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, nor his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, nor his ass, nor anything that is thy neighbor's. These six describe the unrighteous, those who know there is a God, though they may not have surrendered to him, though they may not be broken before him, but choose to love the darkness of their own lusts and their own desires more than they would love the Lord. And it's interesting to me that there's the one that is our relationship with God, the first four verses. And then there's the next six. Our first four commandments, excuse me. The first four commandments is our relationship with God. And the next six commandments is our relationship with each other. The unrighteousness is the relationship with each other. How do you treat those around you? I love teenagers. They have some of the coolest looking eyes when they get mad. Right? I'm serious. They do. And they give me this glare look. I'm getting some of them right now. Why are you picking us on this morning, Brian? What, it's Jaden, not us. All right. But honestly, you know, they have that look. You guys know what I'm talking about, that stony glass look that's just like, I'm piercing through you right now. Right? Their relationship with us. Their relationship with society. Their relationship with how they're going to be as young adults. I'm a boss now in my position at work. And I can almost guarantee you if one of my employees came in and gave me the same look I get from some of the teenagers, they would not be an employee very long. But I love that he says that these next six verses is describing the unrighteousness, if you would. But both the unrighteous and the ungodly end with the same result from our text this morning. God's wrath. God's wrath. Now, I struggled over this text this week a little bit because I thought, you know what? I don't want to spend all my morning talking about the unrighteous and the ungodly because that's not who was getting instructed this morning. Church, this service is not for the edification of the unbeliever. It's for the edification of the saints. And what are we supposed to be and what are we supposed to look like? So in that vein, the Lord showed me a parallel passage to this. But turn back to our main text right now. He says in verse 18, for the wrath of God is revealed. That's the apocalypto, to take off, to discover, to disclose. It's the same word that is used when he says in verse 17, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed. It's being shown to us. He says, the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of the men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. So when was this unveiling to the unrighteous believer? When was this unveiling to the ungodly man? The same place that the revealing of the faith and the power of God and the gospel was. And the coming of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. That is the same place that the unveiling, the revelation came from. The apocalypto, it was no longer hidden. It was made plain and simple and clear. as to what it took to become a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. The wrath of God was revealed in the gospel when God came as a substitution for our sin. And then, as I already pointed out in verse 20, it says, now they are without excuse. But I want you to see why they are without excuse. They are without excuse because of verse 19 and 20. Look at this. Because that was made known of God is manifest in them, for God has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. I want to point it out to you this way, if I could. I want you to notice in that revelation back in verse 18 that it says, the wrath of God is revealed. That's the perfect tense. It happened and is happening. I want you to understand that as we go on this morning. Because it's important for you and I, brother and sister in Christ, to understand that the revelation is still happening today. There are still unrighteous and there are still ungodly people. Lord willing, none sitting in this building today, but they're still there, aren't they? Perhaps you run into them in your workplace. Perhaps you run into them out in the world or in your sporting events or whatever you go to. There are still unrighteous and ungodly people. And the revelation is still happening today. And how is it happening? And how can it be known? And how is it being showed unto them, as it says in verse 19? Through you and I. Through you and I. He showed it initially, even through creation itself. They are without excuse. That's what he says in verse 20. He says that all creation in the world made it clearly seen that there was a God and there is a God. So he showed it to them that way to begin with. And then he came in the form of Jesus Christ. He came in the form of the Son. He allowed himself to be crucified to revelation. And then he gave this to you and I to continue to be that revelation. You and I are the continued revelation of God. We are still revealing what unrighteousness and ungodliness looks like. Hopefully we're revealing it in the positive sense of making sure that we look righteous and godly. Making sure that we look righteous and godly. He says this in verses 19 through 25, that they should know. And then verse 21, pick it up with there with me if you would. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were they thankful, because they became vain in their own imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. They changed the glory of God. Excuse me. They changed the glory of the uncorruptible God to an image made like corruptible man, to the birds, to the four-footed beasts, and the creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Here is the problem, brother and sister. This is what you and I truly face. We are that continued revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ. They are left without excuse because you and I exist. But here's the thing that scared me as I went through this passage this week, is how many of us are perhaps changing the incorruptible or the uncorruptible God into the image of a corruptible man. And you're thinking, what? I never do that. Is God really God in your life? Or is he just somebody that you get together to kind of talk about? Is he really who he says he is? Do you allow him to be who he is? Or is it just something you do because that's your heritage, maybe? You grew up in church. Who is God to you? Is he uncorruptible? Is he all-powerful? Can he do it all? Or do you have him in a box about yay big, and you say, God can't work that way anymore. God doesn't do that anymore. Who is God to you? And isn't it interesting? Look at this, how you see them change what God looks like in verse 23. They changed him, what? From the incorruptible God into the image of man first. Isn't that what we see the world doing all the time? Right? Oh, I believe God exists. I believe we're all God. All of mankind. The way we treat each other. Can't we all just get along? And then they get worse than that. They start to change into birds. Right? Well, at least there's something, you know, that soars above the sky and something beyond what we can do. We can't just flap our arms and take off. They're pretty cool that way. So they change God into a bird. And then they change him into a four-footed beast, like a golden calf. And then they get worse than that. They change him into a serpent. But God's going to give them up to their uncleanliness. But I told you this morning that this was written for you and I. And I already mentioned there's a parallel verse to this that I think helps to show us what we should be compared to what this passage is telling us. Turn with me, if you would, to Ephesians chapter 2. What should we be? How are we going to be the testimony? How are we going to be the ones that leave the world without excuse and their unbelief anymore? Here's how we're going to do it. Ephesians chapter 2, follow along with me if you would as I read verses 1 through 10. And you he hath quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, where in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past, and the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. Okay, I'm going to pause there for a second. He's describing the old nature. It looks a lot like what he described about the ungodly and unrighteous, doesn't it? Those who sought after their own lust, those who fulfilled their own desires, and were by nature the children of wrath. And then he gets into this in verse 4. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, he hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved. And hath raised us up together and made us to sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are ye saved through faith. And that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. That is the parallel and contradictory passage to what we're looking at this morning. We are no longer, as children of God, by nature, children of wrath. We no longer are that. And that's why the world hates us. And that's why they have such a hard time with us. I remember when I became a believer, shortly after I became a believer, I was in love with the Lord. I was studying the Word. I was just in the Word. I was changing the nature of who I was. I started to actually behave like a decent member of society. And my mother called me up. And she says to me, "I need to talk to you, Brian." Okay, sounds good. I went out to her house and sat down to talk with her. And this is how our conversation started. "Tell me about what you've gotten involved in." "I don't understand what you're talking about, Mom." I'm like thinking there's something coming back from my past to haunt me now. What are you talking about? And she's like, "What are you doing every Sunday morning?" "I'm going to church, Mom." "Okay, what church are you going to?" "Christian church, Mom." "What are you doing there?" "I'm learning about Jesus Christ, Mom." "I'm afraid you're involved in a cult." Because so miraculous was the transformation in my life that my family actually thought I'd gotten involved in a cult. "And you're going to tell me God doesn't work in us? That we aren't the testimony of his revelation? That the world thinks it's a weird thing that you want to come here on a Sunday morning? That the world thinks it's a weird thing that you're willing to give up your time watching football to come study the Word of God? We are involved in a cult. Not in the traditional sense of what they say a cult is. We are involved in something that so transforms us that it is foreign to a sick and dying and unbelieving world. And they don't understand it. And you know what? The minute they start to understand it or start to think they understand it, they're faced with no excuse. Because they're going to understand that it's the power of Jesus Christ in you and I that transforms lives. It's the power of who He is and what He's done for us that makes us behave like members of society should behave. That's what's going to happen if they start to understand it. And they're left without excuse. They're left without excuse. It reminds me of Luke. Turn with me to Luke chapter 14. And I'm totally off my notes now, so we're just kind of going here. Follow along with me. They're left without excuse. They'll still make them. The Lord gave a parable about the excuse, didn't He? Look at Luke chapter 14. Read with me if you would. Pick it up verse 15. And when one of them sat at meat, and he heard these things, he said unto him, "Blessed is he that shall eat bread in the kingdom of God." Then he said unto him, "A certain man made a great supper, and bade many, and sent his servants at supper time to say to them that were bidden, Come, for all the things are now ready. And they all with one consent began to make excuses. The first said unto him, I have bought a piece of ground, and I must needs go and see, and pray thee, have me excused. And another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and go to prove them, and I pray thee, have me excused. And another said, I have married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. Must have been some woman. So the servant came and showed his lord these things. And the master of the house, being angry, said to his servants, Go out quickly into the streets and the lanes of the city, and bring in hither the poor and the maimed, the halt and the blind. And the servant said, Lord, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room. And the Lord said unto him to the servant, Go into the highways and the hedges and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. For I say unto you, that none of those men which were bidden shall taste of my supper. You know what's sad is that God desires all should come to the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ and that none should perish. But He had to go out and find you and us in the you and I in the dredges and the highways and the byways and the hedges and say, I'll take that one, that imperfect one. Yeah, I know he doesn't have the best looking clothes and he doesn't look the best and he doesn't talk the best, but I'll take him. Just come to my supper. And we're like, okay, I'm hungry, feed me. And so we came in. And those who should understand these things, those who are the learned men of this world who should understand God, those who study the cosmos, those who study nature, those who study people, are those, for some reason, who seem to be the blindest. Those who have to make excuse for why they can't believe, why they can't come to the supper. But really, in all honesty, the excuse comes down to one point, doesn't it? That they would rather remain in their own lusts and desires. It says in John chapter 1, the Lord came unto his own, and his own received him not. It says that light came into the world, and men loved darkness rather than light, lest their deeds should be exposed. Are you and I willing to be, honestly, that revelation of the Lord? Are we willing to actually let Him in every part of our life? And are we willing to be honest before each other? Guys, I know I'm not the best. I never will be the best at anything. But you know what? I don't need to be the best. David didn't say that when he was called, he was the best. Matter of fact, David said he was the least. And God used him mightily. Why? Because he's a willing vessel. When the Lord called Isaiah, he said, Whom shall I send? The Lord didn't say, Isaiah didn't say, Well, I don't know. I'm not really that good. He said, Here I am, send me. I mean, if that's all you've got, I'll do it. This is what he wants from you and I. In the Great Commission, I actually turn there, Matthew chapter 26. I'm lying to you, it's not 26. My bad. 28. We have no problem understanding this is the Great Commission of the church, right? This is our directive. Pick it up with me at verse 18. And it said, and Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. Do you want to know what we're supposed to be doing? The Great Commission. We're going to have a baptism this morning, and I praise God for that. Because that was our instructions at the church. That we would go and teach them and baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. We would teach them to observe whatever things that he had commanded. And that we would not shun to profane the whole gospel of God and the whole counsel of God. No matter how tight it may make our shoes feel. The reason why it is important for us to understand that there is a wrath of God out there is so we understand that we're the revelation of that wrath. Because the minute we come into the presence of an unbeliever, an ungodly person, and an unrighteous person, even sometimes even to another believer who is living in unrighteousness and behaving unrighteously, that person should be convicted by you and I. That person should question themselves because of the way we behave and what we have become. We are his testimony. We are his testimony. We have the word of life that we share. And hopefully we live. Because we're his testimony. I think I've shared with you guys great many times that one of my greater fears is that one day I will be standing there at the white throne judgment of God, knowing perfectly that I am saved. And I'll see somebody, and I already told you, one of my fears is that somebody would be over there and say, I never told them. My second fear is this, is they would say, but Brian didn't behave like that. Brian didn't do that. Brian was bitter and angry and treated me callously. Brian was rude to me. Brian didn't show me love. Why would I ever want to become a Christian if all I'm going to get is anger and I'm going to get just bitterness and judgmentalism? Don't get me wrong, we judge the fruits. Don't get me wrong, I'm not going to go down to a whole other sermon. But love. He says this in his passage in the gospel. He says that men shall know you're my disciples by what? By the way you treat each other? No. By the way that you tell each other how wrong you are? No. By the way that you do church? No. By your love for one another. I want this body and myself to be the lovingest group in this entire city. If there's one testimony that I want Pocatello Baptist to have, it is that we love each other. And you know what's an interesting thing about love? Jesus loved us, didn't he? We just read in Ephesians chapter 2 that he loved us when we were dead in our trespasses and sins. He loved us. See, the interesting thing about love is love, we oftentimes think of a two-way street, don't we? Well, I'll love them if they love me. That's not the way it works. That's not God's love. God loves all. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever should believe in him should not perish. He didn't say, God so loved those who love him. No, he loved them all. One of the most difficult things that we as believers have to do, guys, is we have to love a world that hates us. We have to love each other when that person treats you in a very unloving manner. Love covers a multitude of sins. By the way, you want to know why we choose to love? We choose to love because it makes us better, not the other person. Somebody can treat me any way they want, and I'm still going to choose to love them because I will be better for that. I will be more the image of my Savior because of that. I jokingly tell the kids all the time that, and then so now they're all nervous whenever I call up and ask if they want to go to coffee, because one of the things I say to them is, I say this, you know, sometimes I hear some pretty wicked things said about me out of the mouth of the teens. It gets back to me because teens love to gossip, right? And it gets back to me some of the things that are said about me, sometimes even by their parents, right? So just be aware of that too, okay? And it gets back to me. And you know what I choose to do? I choose to get bitter and angry at that person and treat them differently. No, I choose to love them. Not that I'm perfect at it, don't get me wrong. There's times that honestly some things that I hear are just downright hurtful. And they break my heart and they make me cry. But oftentimes what I'll do when I hear that and I say, hear somebody talking about me that way or saying something about me or my wife, and it's rude and it's just mean and it's nasty, when the Lord compels me to do so and I know that they'd be willing to come, I'll call them up and say, hey, let's go get coffee. Let's go buy a drink together. Sit down, have a cup of coffee together and talk. And what's funny is sometimes I know that that person knows that I know. Right? And so they sit across the table from me with this look on their face that is just petrified. Oh, it's coming. It's coming. It's coming. And I won't say anything about it. Because it doesn't matter. It says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth does flow. So apparently at some point, that's exactly what they thought of me. I can't help that. I can't help the change. I can't change their thinking at that moment. I can't go back in the past and change what they thought or even said. All I can do is hope to correct the future. So I'll choose to love them. And I'll take them out and we'll have a good time. At least I have a good time. I don't know if they do. And I'll have a good time with them. They may not know I'm having a good time, or they may not know they're having a good time. But we'll have a good time together. We'll have a cup of coffee. And I'll go and I'll drop them off. And it gets back to me again, because like I said, people love to gossip. And it gets back to me again, they're like, Brian didn't say anything about what I said. I don't need to say anything. Right? What did my Lord say? My Lord said, turn the other cheek. Turn the other cheek. How many times, Lord? Endlessly, in all honesty, is the description he gives there, isn't it? Forever. Turn the other cheek. I mean, what is the worst you're going to do to me? Tell me something I don't already know about myself? He walks funny. Yeah, you got that right. Kind of enjoy it. You know how many conversations get started because of the things that are imperfect in me? Right? Even my lisp. Right? When I get really excited, and you guys have all experienced this, all of a sudden my S's just start, right? And it sounds like I'm slobbering. But you know how many conversations I get to have with people in my job because I have a lisp? Because I'll get excited, I'll be talking to them, all of a sudden I'll be like, oh, sorry about that. I didn't mean to drool on you there. Right? How many conversations get started? This is the point. Is I get the opportunity to share the love of Christ with people because of my imperfections. I get to be his testimony because I'm willing to be Brian. And who Brian was created to be, which takes me back to my parallel passage. Look back at Ephesians chapter 2. And we're going to close with this thought, guys. Ephesians chapter 2. Look at verse 10 with me if you would. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath preordained that we should walk in them. The word I really want to look at this morning with you is workmanship. It's a beautiful word in the Greek. And we also, and don't bother turning there because we're going to close with this, but it shows up in our text this morning from Romans chapter 1 and verse 20 when it says the things that are made. It's the same word as workmanship right there. in the Greek. The word is poema, from where we get our word poem. It says that we are his poem. We are his poem. I love poetry. It's actually one of my favorite forms of art. And it says that we're his poem. We were created to be his poem. I on occasion write poems. I'm not really good at it, but I occasionally do, you know. And when I share it, when I write one, one of the worst things about me is I go back and I read it and I think I need to change it again. And so I'm always rewriting my poem. And did you know he's always rewriting us? Right? And he gets the license to do that because he's the artist. He's the artist, so he gets to rewrite us. You can't take one of my poems and rewrite it and say it's yours by changing a couple words. No, that's still my poem. You just plagiarized. He takes you and he makes you his workmanship. He makes you, you his poem and rewrites you. Hopefully daily. Hopefully daily he's rewriting us. And we're changing more and more to his image. Be who God has created you to be. Be who God has made you today. The workmanship of him right now. And allow him to change you as he feels need to. And all of that we want him to do for us because we are the revelation of his son, Jesus Christ, to a sick and dying world.